tumbling down. Here I am. I mean, this has been the craziest day. Everything is sticking. Things are not opening as they should be. My lighting is terrible. We're going to get through this by the seat of our pants today. I open, of course, with I feel the earth move, because today the earth did move here. I was sitting at my desk this morning at 10:30, and all of a sudden, everything in my office started shaking. A book fell off my desk, and I thought, well, first of all, my mom, those of you who know this, and I thank you all for the outpouring of love that I received, my mother passed away a month ago today, and I thought, she's trying to get in touch with me. And then I called my husband, who is across the river in Valhalla, and I said, did you feel the earth move? And he said, yeah, what's going on? And then all of a sudden, I started getting text messages. And it turns out that we had a 4.8 vibration today. And I know a lot of people are making jokes about the fact that it wasn't anything bigger. Be thankful. When I think about what's going on in Taiwan and in other places that have been majorly hit by these earthquakes, we just have to say, this is a wake-up call. So everyone pay attention to what's going on. I have four phenomenal women today. Today is National Go for Broke today. And we are going for broke. I'm going to bring my first guest on, Barb Bailey. How are you, Barb?
I'm awesome. This time it was you that had trouble getting on, remember?
See? I know. And I was patient. I thought I was going to lose my mind. I couldn't get on. And everything was freezing. And even when we started, I downloaded video clips that I want to show today, photographs of upcoming shows. Everything disappeared. Aww. So we're just going to do the best job we can. But how are you, Barb?
I'm awesome. I'm great. I'm really happy to be on today. Yeah. I'm glad we made it.
I am too. And you've been on the road lately. Am I right about that?
Well, yes, but I'm going on the road in 3 weeks. I'm going back to Vibrato in LA, which is Herb Alpert's room.
Yes.
Yeah, third time in 1 year. I'm so honored. It's a beautiful room. Have you ever played it, Richard?
I haven't, but I'm going to be in LA 2 weeks from today.
Oh,
I'm
going to
be in Palm Springs on the 19th. And then I'm going to be, I don't want to talk about what's happening in LA right now, because I don't know if you're aware of this or even if you put any credence in this, but right now we are in the midst of Mercury retrograde.
On top of
all of that, we are having an eclipse on Monday. So everything is really kaflooey right now.
I know. Scary.
Are you feeling it?
Yeah, scary. I'm in Chicago, as you know, and we didn't have the tremor or whatever New York had. Mm-hmm. But it could be coming our way. It could be tonight.
I hope not.
I hope
if you feel the earth move tonight, it's for all the right reasons.
Exactly. I mean, we're all thinking that.
So, I mean, what is it about this venue in California that brings you back? I mean, we live now. I've just come back to doing live performances.
Yes.
After 13 years.
Yeah.
I did a few shows in New York a few years ago. But this is the first time that I have been going on the road. And you also are a manager You're a booking agent. And I want to ask you, it seems to me that everything, speaking of the earth moving, that everything has shifted in terms of the way that these venues book anymore. And I'm finding that it's getting harder and harder to really make a living at this. And I, you know, 13 years ago when I was on the road, I made a very good living doing what I did. It changed.
I know, you're speaking to the jury. I mean, I've been in the business since college. I won't tell you how long that's been, but it's been quite long. And, you know, as an agent and as a manager, and ever since the pandemic, everything is sideways, isn't it?
Oh, it absolutely is. Do you think that it's going to shift back, or do you think that this is the new normal?
I think it's the new normal with some shifting, but we're all going to have to push back together to make it shift, because there's not people answering phones anymore.
Yeah.
People want to text that you don't even know, right? I don't text to do business. I'd rather talk on the phone, email. I'm really old school.
Well, I'm very old school as well, but you know, it's not just in our profession. You know, I saw a posting today. If you go to the supermarket, and we all go to the supermarket, there's the self-checkout lines.
Oh yeah.
And I have a friend whose daughter is working her way through college, and she has begged us not to go to the self-checkout lines.
Really?
Because she said it takes away from them hiring honest to God people. And years ago, I used to do a lot of temp work. And we're talking in the 80s, actually. And the one job that I kept getting over and over and over again was in customer service. And every place, I'll pat myself on the back on this one, practically every place that I went to wanted to hire me full time because they said they just loved what I did with the customer. And the bottom line is, treat the customer the way that you would like to be treated if you were in the same position. And I think that what's missing is that when we are dealing with customer service, which is frustrating for everybody now, that if the person that you're dealing with on the other side said, I'm sorry you're having an issue, let me see what I can do to help you.
Yeah.
Everything would turn around.
They don't do that. They're looking at the clock to see how much more time they have to work, you know, and can go home. I'm so upset with all of that. But one of the reasons I work vibrato so much is, well, of course, they ask me.
That's always good.
I know, but they're so personable there. Herb Alpert himself, you know, my last show in November, did the announcement for Barb Bailey. That's kind of unheard of, right? Although, I don't know if Gianni does that at Birdland. I think he might, actually. I just booked somebody at Birdland.
Oh, good.
Yeah, one of my national clients. I have national and I have local to Chicago. I have a lot of national clients. And he's also going to be at Vibrato 1 week before I am. That's Bob Anderson.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful.
You know, he's the greatest singing impressionist. He'll be there April 25th and I'm there May 1st. So I'm going to hook on, you know, a little vacay while I'm out there. I'll announce him from the stage and then I'll stay for a week and then I'll do it. I'll do my show on May 1st.
That's great.
Wonderful there, Richard. If you're out there when I'm there, I will introduce you to them.
I would love this. We're going to bring on our next guest. But before I do, as I do on my Friday wrap-up show, I've laid out 4 mystery cards. So pull a number 1 through 4, and we'll see what that is. And then I'm going to bring on our next guest.
Oh, okay. Number 3.
And your card is... I'm going to turn this around because I want to go positive. Who is the best boss that you've ever had and what made them the best boss?
Well, I've almost always been my own boss. I'm an independent contractor since I left college. So, I've worked for a lot of music producers as their agent out of my agency, basically. Mm-hmm. But the music producers, for instance, the first one, I think your first one is your best, don't you? Because if they were good, you're still in the business 40 years later. And that would have been Bobby Whiteside in Chicago, mm-hmm. out of Universal Recording Studio. He taught me a lot about not only music, but the street. You know, you're in New York, I'm in Chicago. If you just know the technical side of everything, that isn't enough, right? You have to know the street and how to figure people. And he really helped me a lot with that. And I owe a lot of course, music to him as well, and connections, because when he moved to Nashville, I moved to LA.
Wow.
Yeah, he was awesome.
Well, I'm going to bring on our next guest, but before I do, and I'm having trouble, my uploader, for lack of a better word, is not pulling things up. So I'm going to try a different method of doing this. I hope it works, and then I'm going to bring her on. So I saw her show about a month or so ago. She's bringing it back. She's nominated for a MAC Award. Okay. For those of you who do not know, that's the Manhattan Association of Cabarets, and it's the Oscars of cabaret, and she truly deserves it. And here she is, singing a selection from the show. I hope this is going to work here.
I can dance a tango. I can read Greek. I can slay a dragon any old week. Easy. What's hard is simple. What's natural comes hard. Maybe you could show me how to let go. Lower my guard. Learn to be free. Maybe if you whistle for me.
That's one of my favorite songs.
Me too.
By one of my favorite singers from one of my favorite shows that I've seen in recent months.
Oh, thank you so much.
It's true. I love, love, love the show. And again, like I said, because of everything shifting today, everything got knocked out of my queue. But this is from your show, celebrating your relationship. And it was a relationship with the master himself, Stephen Sondheim. And you're bringing it back on May 15th.
We are bringing it back on May 15th. I'm thrilled and half bewildered that we've had enough requests to do it again, that we're going to do it again. It's very, first of all, like watching yourself on video when you're also on camera reacting to yourself. 0 stars. Do not recommend that experience.
I mean, I couldn't get it on to take up the whole screen. That was the only way I could do it.
I was glad that, I mean, I'm impressed that you got all of this together, because I know you were having difficulties, but we've talked about this before. It's such a personal story for me. It's so personal that many people who've known me for like 30 years didn't even know that I had this long time, almost lifelong correspondence with Sondheim. A friend of mine was saying it to me, it was my dentist. I've been with my dentist for 20 years. And he goes, why didn't you ever tell me? I'm like, when would have been a good moment for me to tell you this, when you had like your drill in my mouth?
Well, before we get too far, I also want to acknowledge that incredible man at the piano.
That's why I included his piano solo. That's my husband, Michael Guerin. Yes. And he has a name in this business. Without me, he co-wrote and co-starred in Song of Singapore. He's been around in every boat in Manhattan for the last 40 years. And he's the house pianist at the Roxy Hotel down in Tribeca. Mm-hmm. I should plug that. If you're down there, he plays from 6 to 8 every Tuesday through Saturday. So he's the happy hour pianist of the Roxy.
I want to ask you, I mean, first of all, I envy you having, if you'll pardon the expression, excuse me, Michael, a built-in musical director.
I mean, it wasn't an accident.
No. Because, I mean, trying to get musicians together. I mean, right now, as I mentioned earlier, I am going out west in another week. And I'm performing in Palm Springs and in LA. Luckily for me, I have the same musical director for both gigs, but my bass player and my percussionist are going to be different in each venue.
Right.
And that excites me too. Mm-hmm. But to know that you can travel with Michael and it's so inclusive, I want to know what your process is at home, because you live together, you work together. Are there moments where you just say, I need some time?
There was a famous week last summer. We have written a musical together as well. It's called Mary Astor's Purple Diary, based on the book by the illustrator Ed Sorrell. So I wrote the book and he wrote the music and lyrics for the musical. We've been doing this cabaret thing. We did the pandemic together and we were live streaming twice a week. And, you know, we try to, we go to other people's shows together, et cetera, et cetera. And there was a moment last summer where I turned to him and said, no offense, babe, but if I don't get out of town for a few days, there's going to be a murder suicide. I'm going to kill us both. And I might do me first.
It's so funny because, I mean, my husband, he's going to, and I can say this, at the end of this month, he's going to be 70, which surprises both of us. And he was in his 30s when we met. So we've been together a long time. But he is thinking of the R word. He's not in show business. So those of us in the business, we never say the R word. But he is thinking of retiring. And the pandemic gave us a taste of what life would be together almost 24/7. And we are still together. So
yes.
So I'm going to bring our next guest on. And we're going to get back to some more things in a moment. But
before that, I wanted to say that I saw your show a couple of weeks ago and I absolutely loved it. You came to mine and said, my experience with Carol Channing was so similar to yours with Stephen Sondheim. I knew that you really got it when you came to my show. And it was wonderful to see yours and to share that similar experience that we both had. And you're such a fantastic performer. I wanted to put that out there before we go any further. Wanted to get a chance to say that.
So there are three cards laid out. So pull the number 1 through 3, and then I'm going to bring on our next guest.
I'll take 2.
And the question is, I love this card. Which piece are you when you play Monopoly and why?
The top hat, because New York City, the hub of sophistication in the universe. I would always be the top hat. But I really, really stink at Monopoly. And I really stink at capitalism in general, I must say. So I try never to play a Monopoly. I would much rather play something like Trivial Pursuit.
Well, I'm going to tell you, and this is something that they've started doing in recent years. There's a Wizard of Oz Monopoly, which is a lot of fun. And there are Monopoly games built around different movie themes.
Yes.
So that's a lot of fun.
Those I might enjoy.
Well, I want to ask our next guest, and that's Barbara Minkus. So Barbara, can you hear me, Barbara? I don't think she can hear me. Barbara? Mm-hmm. Barbara? Barbara, can she see me? Can she hear me?
No.
I don't think she can hear me. Well, we're Barbara. Hello, Barbara. She can't see me. Barbara. I'm going to bring our next guest on. Barbara, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing great. I'm telling you, Mercury is in retrograde, and all kinds of crazy things are going on. So, Deborah, what Monopoly piece are you?
Gosh, I haven't played Monopoly in so long. I don't remember all the pieces. I mean, I remember there's an iron, but that's the last piece I remember.
That is still there after all these years. Can you believe that?
Yeah, well, you know, there's an iron in the back of some closet of mine. You know, In fact, I hemmed the pants that I'm going to wear at my show, and I thought, oh, I should really press these pants. And then I was so impressed that I even said that. I haven't done it.
So let's talk about your shows. You've got a new show that's coming up at Don't Tell Mama. Then you also have a, is it a chocolate satyr?
It is. It's the Chocolate Satyr Cabaret, the second annual Chocolate Satyr Cabaret, which is like a crazy thing. For years, I would do chocolate satyrs with children in my congregation. And then I thought, well, gosh, in my family, we would always do song show tunes at the end of our Seder. So I rewrote some show tunes to have lyrics that reflect the Seder, put it together in a Haggadah, translated all of the items, the ritual items into chocolate so that we have four glasses of chocolate milk and chocolate covered matzah and peppermint patties for the bitter herbs and that kind of thing. and everybody gets a little bag with those things. And then I have what I call the Seder Sages, some folks from our cabaret community who are invited to choose a song of their choice on one of the themes of Passover. So freedom, redemption, home, family, any of those things. And this year I'm very pleased that our Seder Sages are Sidney Meyer, Lenny Watts, Lena Moy Borgen and her son, her 8-year-old son, Nathan. And from the UK, visiting because he's nominated for a Mac Award, is Daniel Kaner. And then I'll be singing as well. And some year, I hope that Marty Millett will be one of my Seder Sages, but she will be out of town that night. And all the money goes to some organization. Last year it was for HIAS that helps with refugee resettlement. This year we're doing it an organization that helps mentor wounded soldiers. So I'm very excited about this. It's the 18th of April at 7 p.m. at Don't Tell Mama. And it is the second show I will be doing at Don't Tell Mama that week, which is a little crazy making, but I'm thrilled.
I am too. If you can send me all the information, this is true of all of you, any information that we talk about today, send those links to me and I will get them on the YouTube channel so that we can help get the word out with everything. And I hope that Barbara Minkus eventually will be able to weigh in with us. But she's here. We can see her. Barbara is one of my oldest and dearest friends out on the West Coast. But Deborah, I had a friend years ago, and I don't know how long you and Marty have been around in the cabaret scene, but I don't know if you knew Geerte Groenen. And Geerte Groenen did a show, she's now moved on, but she did a show every Christmas called A Jewish Girl's Christmas.
Oh.
And it was one of my favorite shows that I looked forward to year after year after year. And it was all about her growing up as a Jewish girl with all of her Gentile friends celebrating Christmas and how she convinced her family to bring those traditions into their family so they celebrated everything. And I quite frankly, am I celebrate everything. Barbara, Barbara, can you hear me? She still can't hear me. I don't know where she is. I'm gonna mute her. Everything was it's one of those shows that I look forward to year after year after year.
That's great. Well, you know, my last show was called Jewish Caroling, and it was the music of Carol King, Carol Bayer Sager, and Carolyn Lee. Yes. And everyone assumed that it was a show about Christmas carols written by Jews, of which most of them are.
Yes, so, that's true.
So for an open mic, what I did with my son was we put together 15 Christmas carols written by Jews in a 6-minute medley. And that's what I would sing around in December when I went to open mics, even though that was not at all what my show was about.
Well, so. Good for you. Good for you.
Yeah.
So, you know, on my Friday wrap-up show, I like to talk about process. I like to talk about creativity. I am a huge follower of Julia Cameron, the artist way. I do my artist way morning pages every morning. I take it an artist date at least once a week. So I have put together questions based on my reading and my studying throughout this week. And so we're going to have a little fun with this. And I'm going to start with you, Barb. And the question is, I mentioned that I start my day with the morning pages. How do you start your day each day?
With a lot of coffee. Honestly, a lot of coffee. I don't get on the phone because my voice does not cooperate. As soon as I get up, I need coffee. And I take, you know, my vitamins an hour later, because you can't take them together. You know that.
Well, I want to tell you, I'm a big coffee drinker, and I have learned that the first drink of the day should be water.
Oh, I do that too.
Yeah, good. But before you have coffee, because coffee will tend to dehydrate the body. And when I'm doing a show, and this is difficult for me, but I do it, I don't drink coffee for the week leading up to the show.
I don't either.
Oh my God.
I'm the same way. I go into training. Yeah. I do. I'm in training now for my show on the 1st of May. I don't drink coffee. In another week, I won't have any alcohol.
Yeah.
Coffee. They're all off limits.
Yes. You
know? And it's really good, isn't it, to do that? Because otherwise our vocal cords constrict. Mm-hmm. And God knows I need all the help I can get.
Oh, I do too. I mean, and I find that as I get older, that's the case. Marty, I love this question that I found this week. It says, imagine your life as a book. What title would this chapter be? And what would the next title, what would the title of the next chapter be?
The title of this chapter would be, While You're Still Breathing, There's Still Hope. That's something that my therapist said to me a few years ago when I said, well, I didn't do this and I didn't do that. And I tried to do this cabaret thing in 2001 and I just didn't find the scene welcoming, and I'm never going to this or that. And she was like, well, how old are you? And at the time I was like, you know, 48 or something. And she goes, are you dying next week? Are you planning on checking out? I was like, no. She's like, if you want to do these things, there's no reason for you. Anyway, that's what she said. While you're still breathing, there is hope for you to achieve something that you want to do. And as soon as I opened the door with an attitude of welcoming whatever opportunities I might have, instead of assuming that it was going to be slammed in my face. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that everything I wanted immediately fell at my feet, but it became a lot easier. The path has less resistance in it when you approach it that way. The next chapter, I hope will be, and then she finally relaxed. How about that one? That's the one I would really like.
I love that. That's great. That's great. Barbara, if you can hear me, give me a thumbs up. She still can't hear me. Okay, Deborah, your question is, when was the last time that you felt most joyful And what steps did you could you take to recreate that moment?
Gosh, I would say I would answer that on two levels, because on one level, anytime I get to sing is one of the most joyful moments of my life. And if I am doing it collaboratively, as I am with my son and Lenny Watts with this show happening, or with other class shows or whatever things I've done, then the joy is that much deeper because it's shared with other people. Mm-hmm. So that's certainly a tremendous joy. And then I feel very fortunate. I've got three wonderful kids, and even though I only sing with one of them, moments that I get to spend with those with my family are among my most joyful. And I have two granddaughters who live in Jerusalem, and I saw them last month, and those moments are exquisitely joyful. They're just fabulous.
And do your other two kids sing as well? And do your grandchildren sing?
Well, yes. My other two kids sing. My other son, the father of the two daughters, he's a tremendous musician. He's an incredible singer. Wow. and he plays just about everything. My daughter is a visual artist, and she'll sing, but under duress.
Okay.
Yeah. And the granddaughters sing a lot in their daycare. In fact, this morning we got a video from Adam. He brought his guitar to their daycare, and he sang Passover songs because they're getting ready for Passover. So music is a really big part of our lives. Really, really big.
Oh, and I can't imagine our lives without it.
Yeah.
Barb, when it comes to your art, name three words that you would like, or phrases that you wish to be known for when it comes to your artistry.
Truthfulness. Probably love, you know. I like to come from love in my artistry a lot. I like to be truthful in my artistry completely, and generous with others on stage and with my audience.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's great. Marty, when people talk about you when you're not around, what do you hope that they're saying? Or do you think about it?
Are you kidding me? I don't think about anything else. This is why I have anxiety. Yes, I hope it's something that I, as a kid and as a young person, didn't think too much about. I thought, well, I'm going to be good, and then I'm going to get work, and then people will like me because I'm talented. But it doesn't work that way.
Welcome to show business.
Yes, exactly. I hope that people, I always hope that people will say, she's funny. I still do care about that, but I now also care that people feel safe with me. And that's not the kind of thing that people actually would say about you. I hope that they will say, she's a nice person. I was going through a rough time, and she gave me some good advice, or she was kind to me. Let me vent to her or whatever. That's what I hope. I hope people will say that I was kind.
I like what you just said, that that people feel safe with you.
Yes.
I think that if we can all accomplish that, I think that we're on to something. That's really good. I like that. Deborah, in this profession, are there moments when you have difficulty telling the truth? And if so, how do you deal with it?
Telling the truth on stage or telling the truth to other people?
Any way you want to take that.
Any way I want to take it. Okay. Well, I'm a pretty private person. I spent the bulk of my adulthood learning that it was about other people and not about me. So I tend not to be. In fact, one of the biggest surprises that I found when I began doing cabaret, and I'm kind of new to this relatively to most other people, is that I was allowed to use the word I.
Yeah.
You know, that it's about me. Oh my God, it's about me? Really? It's not about only about you? That was a big surprise. So So being able to kind of bear my soul on stage is something that I'm working on. That's still not something that comes natural, because it's been socialized out of me because of the world that I was part of. And I just want to actually, if I can, I just want to say that Marty Millett is not only one of the safest people I know, but also one of the kindest. That our first interaction came on the night that we learned that Stephen Sondheim had died.
Wow.
That's right.
And we cried together, and she was so generous in telling me her story about that relationship with Sondheim, so that a few months later, I was invited to talk about Stephen Sondheim's music and life as a Zoom presentation. And Marty sat down and wrote out her story for me, that I could share it with this other community. And I will never forget that. So talented, kind, and safe. They are all words that describe Marty Millett.
And I will say, I'm going to say it again, May 15th, if you haven't seen the show, go and see it. And if you've seen it, see it again. I love the show.
Thank you. And it's at the Laurie Beachman Theater.
Sorry about that. So Barb, when it comes again to your art, are there any major decisions that you've been putting off? And if so, why do you feel that you're putting those decisions off?
You know, that's crazy. That's a loaded question, isn't it? I have to say, if you knew me, I don't put anything off. I'm a 24/7 girl. All I think about is my art, not just mine, but my clients, because I'm a music agent and a manager too. And what was part two of that question? There was another.
And why do you feel that you're putting it off?
Yeah, if I were putting anything off, it would only be because it wasn't enough time. Mm. I mean that because I've learned, because I've been, you know, I've had my own company for so long in the business, Barb Bailey Entertainment. Now I have BarbBaileyMusic.com. Boy, I don't put anything off, and I keep notes, you know, and we all know, because we're in this crazy business, that when we wake up in the morning, the day is never what we thought it was going to be, ever. So all my notes are right in front of me, and I'll move them over here because something else came up, and it's much more crucial, much more important in the moment, you know.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, it's funny. I'm working with a career coach. I'm going to give her a shout out, Patrice McKinley, and she's phenomenal. And we had a session yesterday, and we were talking about leadership. And I don't want to go into a lot of details for a lot of reasons, but I am performing in LA on the 21st. And so the venue and everything has been set up for my performance. And I found out when I signed my contract that they don't have a tech person on staff, that I would have to provide my own tech person, and that I would have to bring in, I'm bringing in a stage manager. Both of them went to check out the venue yesterday. And they called me at 6:30 last night, 3:30 LA time, to say, just to let you know, there's no lighting here. It's just like turning on a light switch and turning it off. And those of you who have seen my show know that video is very much part of the show. The video screen is downstage instead of upstage. There's a piano on stage. I cannot use the piano because the piano belonged to Charlie Chaplin, and I cannot move. I cannot touch the piano. I cannot move the piano, you know, any of these things. And so as this is all unfolding, I am finding out that this place is just not conducive for me to do my show. So now they are scrambling around to find a new venue for me. There's a theater that our fingers are crossed, but it's going to be a rental, and it's not cheap. So you talk about getting up in the morning and your everything changing. I have promoted this. I have bought postcards, banners outside the theater, everything. And now I have to regroup everything and start finding another venue to do my show. I don't want to let go of that date and the time because I have a lot riding on that particular show for a lot of reasons. But talk about things just going in a completely different direction. It's not what I thought it was going to be. So
how big a venue do you need?
I'm looking I could do anything from 20 seats to Carnegie Hall. I mean, the size of the venue is not the issue for me. It's just having all of the elements that I need to present a theatrical presentation. That's the big issue for me. And if this theater comes through, even though it's going to cost me more than I thought, it will answer all my prayers. So that's
fingers crossed.
It's such a great show, Richard. I really hope that you get the venue that suits the show, because that show has so many moving parts.
I know. And kudos to James Beeman, who put those moving parts together. So
beautifully.
I want to give him. Marty, I want to ask you, what's the one choice that you feel that you've made when it comes to your art or your career that you feel supersedes every other decision that you've made? I think I know the answer.
I mean, Michael Garron.
Yes, yeah.
To use the Yiddish term beshert,
yes,
it's not even a strong enough term for how Michael and I came together. And it was 19 years ago on April 18th. It was April 18th, 2005. We met at Jim Caruso's cast party.
Wow. And you're also going strong.
Yes. We were both married to other people, but we were both on our way out of very, very unhappy situations.
Wow.
And we made music together for a time, you know, when we were not yet free, but we confessed to each other later on. We both knew that this was it. It was really the across a crowded room, Love American Style, fireworks, the whole
Adramikas, by the way, was a regular on. I don't know if you know that or not.
Oh, really? No.
Yes, she was a regular on Love American Style.
Oh, I love that show.
She get on. I hope she's watching.
I want to hear some stories about Avery Schreiber.
I loved him. A funny guy.
But me too. But Michael, aside from, hey, he plays the piano for me, what he's done for my self-esteem, he said, oh my God, you can act. When I had been married to a theater director who was constantly telling me, you're not an actor, you're just a performer. You just perform. You're not really any good. And Michael would tell me I was funny, where, you know, my ex would be like, it's not funny. So just all of my self-confidence. And frankly, I did the same for him. He was coming out of a situation where everything was criticized, everything was picked apart, everything he did was scolded. So we come from similar backgrounds, and we both craved that kindness so much. We both needed a little sunshine and water.
That's amazing. I mean, yeah. I feel the same way in my relationship. Because I was in a similar relationship that you described, where people are not laughing with you. They're laughing at you. You should stop doing what you're doing.
Yes.
And it's this constant water torture of, you know, drips, you know, but after a while you drown, you know.
Right. With that water. So I'm just telling you this for your own good. I mean, don't you want to know the truth? Yeah. And it's like, I don't like your truth. And
yours.
Right. And I should also clarify that both of our exes are fine human beings in their own right. These were just marriages that shouldn't have happened in the first place. They're both of these people are happy with their subsequent spouses, and everybody's fine. But
chocolate and scrambled eggs.
Yes.
It just does not go together.
That's right.
Deborah, do you feel that you have the career that you envision for yourself? And if not, what changes need to take place for you to have the career that you desire? Because I know that your performing career is another career that you have. And you can talk about the other career if you'd like to as well.
Sure. So for 35 years, I was a congregational rabbi. And I serve congregations up and down the Eastern Seaboard, primarily in Western Massachusetts in the Berkshires. And I loved that career. I loved being a rabbi. I was also the cantor of the congregation. So I did lots and lots of music. And I thought that was it. That was what I wanted to do for a very long time. I was very happy doing it. And then I took a cabaret class in the Berkshires that somebody was offering. And I realized that there was something else out there. What made me make the leap was, there were two things that made me make the leap. My dad died at 70. And it was about 30 seconds after he had retired. And mm-hmm. I thought to myself, that's not the way I want my life to mm-hmm. that's not how I want my life to end up. I also was surrounded, my congregants, many of them were young retirees who were leading these active, vibrant lives.
Oh, wait, do you see my screen shaking?
Yes.
We're having another
We're having an aftershock.
Are you feeling it as well?
No.
No.
Not here.
Oh, I'm in Chicago, so.
My house is shaking. I'm sorry, Deborah.
Oh my God.
No, that's okay. Wow. Well, that was, that tells you that I was speaking the truth.
Yes.
she has a direct line.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I don't know about that. You have as much a direct line as I do, believe me. But I thought to myself, I want to emulate those people who are living the next chapter of their lives with vibrancy and joy and excitement. And I had so many of those things as a rabbi, but I didn't have the outlet for doing the secular singing that was beginning to be a great passion for me. And so the year after my youngest child graduated college, I, with the blessing of my husband, who is the loveliest person in the world and so supportive, I retired early. And I moved to New York and I started studying and started taking classes and started doing open mics. And so I'm really late to this relative to so many other people, but I am so grateful. I love what I'm doing. I feel so fulfilled. The two shows that I have done have been just, I've loved doing them. I've loved working on them. And now to have this new show that I'm doing with my son, that's heaven on earth, it's just great. So I could sing all day, every day. I wish I had more opportunities. You know, it's hard to break into this world, to rise to the level of being noticed. So I just push myself out there as much as I can. So.
My Alexa just went off. It's the weirdest thing here. That's amazing, Deborah. Thank you for that. Barb, I want to ask you, what is the biggest mind change that you've had as your career has progressed that has changed, that was different from where it was when you first started out?
Well, you know, now I'm a late bloomer too, Deborah, because I've been a manager and an agent for years and years. And only about 10 years ago did I start singing and performing, you know, so that's been a total mindset, blowing my mind. Like, what am I doing? I mean, I'm loving it. I'm thirsting for it. I can't wait to do it again. I never get nervous. People who know me are like, oh, don't you get nervous? I can't wait to get up there and do it, right? I love being on a limb. And so, I mean, that's just a whole mindset change for me, because I was planning to be a very good agent and a very good manager, you know, and I work very hard for all of my clients to help them in their career. So that would be a big one.
That's great. Now, as we are going to wrap up in just a moment, I want to ask each of you, and I'll start with you, Barbara, again. What is the one thing that you've seen or heard this week that really filled your soul artistically from someone else?
You mean about my work?
No, someone who's used a show that you saw, a movie you saw, a song you heard this week.
Oh my goodness. Well, I've seen some really cute movies lately. And one of them was, it's a crazy, it's Arthur the Great, and it's about a dog. And it's not like this artistic giant, but sometimes don't we just have to get away from those big, big movies and just see something that moves the soul? And that's what this dog does. And he just, if you get a chance to see it, you just want to break from Hollywood, and which, why would we want to break from Hollywood and all of the things that we do?
Sometimes we need to, yes.
You know, why would we want to do that? But it's just so loving, and it's not about the dog only. The dog really enters the picture as an add-on in this movie, and Arthur is the name of the dog, and I don't want to give it away, but it was so inspiring. You know, the love of an animal, we all know that love of an animal. It's not like any Richard, I know you have a doggy, don't you?
A dog, and I unfortunately had to put one of my cats down this week.
I'm sorry.
So, yeah, thank you. That. So just on Tuesday. So yes.
That's a trouble. They're like family. I'm so sorry.
Yes, but, thank you.
But sometimes it's fun to get away from just people and watch people intermingle with animals. You
yes,
know?
Absolutely.
And this was a very loving, smart animal. I mean, as smart as most human beings, right?
Great. Marty, same question. A show, a song, film, anything that you saw this week that filled your soul?
This is going to sound weird, but the first thing I thought of was a meme.
That's fine. That's
and
fine.
I'm on a bunch of meme pages. If you follow me on Facebook, you know that I post a lot of funny memes. But sometimes I post things that are more thoughtful or more spiritual. Sometimes they're therapy related because I've had a lot of that. This is one, I just saw this yesterday. Gentle reminder of how emotionally safe people show up in relationships. They make sure you know you're a priority to them. They reflect and validate your emotions and experiences. They set and hold boundaries with you and others. They can accept feedback without becoming defensive. They make time to engage in their own interests and hobbies and encourage you to do the same. They ask questions and hold space for your feelings, even if they don't always understand them. They recognize their own maladaptive behaviors and put effort into healing and personal growth. There's only two more. They show interest in the things that are important to you. They are consistent in the ways that they show up for you. I had a past that was lacking all of those things. That's the roll of the dice. What you're born into, you don't have any control over that. But once you realize that there's something better out there and you're choosing the people that get to be in your life, this is a nice little checklist, isn't it?
I love it.
And I'm very fortunate at this moment in my life to have a bunch of people, not just my husband, but friends that I've chosen to be on this part of the journey with me that really tick off most of those boxes. I'm very, very lucky. I finally got smart too.
Remarks. That's great. And Deborah, same thing, something that filled your soul this week artistically.
So I've been doing lots and lots and lots of research about the Rogers and Gettle family because of my show. And on Monday night, I went to Classic Stage Company's gala, which was Classics Gone Mad, focusing on the music of Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Wow.
And I was in heaven. They, fabulous performers singing the songs that I just adore. And then the end of the show was a sing-along. And everybody in the audience got up and went and stood around the piano.
Wow.
And these were definitely Rodgers and Hammerstein nerds like me. So we were singing our hearts out. We were acting out songs. We were jumping around like we were kids. So I loved hearing the music and being able to sing with all of these people together. It was heaven I use that phrase a lot because I've been lucky. Heaven on earth. It was just exquisitely beautiful. And it gave me such a nice sort of prelude to doing the show next week. You know, I said, oh yeah, I love this music. I love sharing this music. I don't think you would have an Adam Gettle sing-along particularly.
Well, you never know.
You never
know. I will
know.
Say that later this month, I think it's later this month, on PBS, there's going to be a big Rodgers and Hammerstein gala that was recently filmed in London. And as my dear friend Howard Tucker just pointed out, Shirley Jones just turned 90 yesterday. So that was great. I love all of you, and you all fill my soul, and I'm going to give each of you a chance to have your final word in just a moment. It could be about anything that we spoke about today that you want to build upon, anything that we didn't talk about that you wish we had, or just any final message you want to leave everyone with today. And I'll start with you, Barb, and then Deb, and then Marty. I'm going to let you finish. And when you say goodbye, I'm hoping I'm going to get your, I've got another clip from your show that we're going to end with.
Okay.
but I want to thank, you know, I have a guilty pleasure. And I'm going to share this with everyone. And every day at 12 noon, I stop whatever I'm doing and I turn on MeTV and I watch The Waltons. When I was growing up, my grandparents, everyone called me John Boy because they said that character reminded them of me. And as I was watching it today, John Boy comes to New York to write his first novel. And he comes to New York and the novel gets rejected. And that triggers a series of things that go wrong in his life. He loses his job. He loses his apartment. Mm-hmm. He is sleeping on a park bench in Central Park. All of this happens in an hour, by the way. Mm-hmm. He falls asleep and while he's asleep on the park bench, someone comes up and steals his typewriter, which is his main means of doing this. The secondary story, there's always a secondary story, are the Baldwin sisters who want to have a party with all of the people that went to their finishing school. And they send these invitations out. And of course, they were in finishing school 50 years ago. So most of those people have either passed on or they're not able to get there for whatever reason. But they did a speech at the end of the show that they realized that they had spent a large portion of their life being spectators instead of participants. And that all of us have the opportunity to be participants each and every day by watching a sunrise or a sunset or watching an eclipse on Monday or feeling the earth move or all of the things that happen daily that we take for granted. And those of you who watch my shows on a regular basis, and I say this at the end of my live shows as well, I tell everyone to go out and do something nice for somebody else without expecting anything in return. As I've told a lot of people, my mom passed away a month ago today. And that morning we spoke and I was able to tell her that I love her and she had a heart attack and died in her sleep that night. So it came with absolutely no warning. There was nothing to prepare my sister, my brothers, her siblings for what happened. My mom was the oldest of 16 children.
Oh my God.
And so I have a lot of aunts and uncles and cousins and everything. And it was great to see them sad under the circumstances, but I am so grateful that I had that conversation with her that morning. And I reached out to a friend of mine on Facebook today who's out of the country right now. And I just said, I'm just checking in to say hello and how are you? And he said, what prompted you to reach out to me? And I said, just to say hello, that's all. So I tell everyone to, and do this, everybody here, everybody watching, everybody who will see this on the replay later, go to your Facebook friends list and the fourth name that pops up, reach out with a phone call. Not an email message, not a text message, not a private inbox message, but a phone call. And let that person know the impact that they've made on your life. And by doing so, you're going to make an impact on their life. I have a dear friend, Sean Moniger, who I'll be seeing later tonight. And Sean Moniger says, we're all in the same storm, but we're in different size boats. And I always say, I don't care what size boat you're on, as long as you have a skipper by your side.
Oh,
you know that? Barb, it's yours. And then turn over to Deborah. And then we'll end with Marty. And then another selection for Marty's show. Thank you all. And go see a live show. It's all yours.
And I wish I had seen your show, Richard. That's the problem. I don't live in New York. I know there are airplanes out there. I could have flown in. But we should talk about LA, but not now. I guess I'm a very grateful girl because I think Richard knows this. I was found as a baby in a cardboard box when I was 1 week old. And my mother had left me someplace that she knew I'd be taken care of, and that I was not in a dumpster. I was not in the Ohio River. I was left inside the Tally Ho apartment building in Wheeling, West Virginia. And the caretaker spundled. Yeah.
That's where I'm from.
What? You're from Wheeling, West Virginia?
I'm from across the river in Shadyside, Ohio. Go ahead.
Oh my God.
And I'm a Pittsburgh girl.
Then do you know the Tally Ho apartments on National Road?
I've heard of it. I was like,
I was found in a box right inside the door of the Tally Ho apartments. And the caretaker took me downtown. I became known in the newspapers, the Tally Ho baby. And then the state of West Virginia took care of me, you know, provided for me for 1 month, hoping my mother would come back and claim me, right? Well, a month passed, and there was a dinner party for Judge McKee, and this young prominent attorney and his wife, Lucretia and George Bailey. That's really his name. George, I mean, who can write this, right? So anyway, George Bailey and Lucretia went up to him and said, so, Judge, whatever happened to the Tally Ho baby? Did her mother come back and claim her? And he said, no, Monday morning, we're sending her to Charleston to the state orphanage. You know what? They said, no, you're not. We're going to adopt her. So that morning in his chambers, they adopted the Tally Ho baby, sight unseen, just to save the baby's life. And my mother never came back. I never searched for her because I love what she did for me. Obviously, she didn't have the funds to take care of a baby, but she put me in a place where I would be found, right? And taken care of. And I think, I not only think, I know that was an intervention from God. And I'm getting teary, but I am forever grateful about that. And so I just want to say to everybody, keep believing. It's always half full. It's how you look at life. Do as much for others as you possibly can. You know, God bless you, Deborah.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Marty, we need to talk.
Yes. Friend me on Facebook.
Well, okay. What a small world. And
tiny.
Deborah, I have something to say to you too, but I don't think we have time, about My Way and Peter Allen, Carol Bayer Sager. Ah. It took them 2 years to get Frank Sinatra to sing My Way. And in an interview, Peter Allen said, you know, for 2 years, I kept saying to Carol Bayer Sager, don't you think we ought to give our song to somebody else? And Carol would say, you don't take a song away from Frank Sinatra. So 2 years later, he finally recorded, not My Way. I'm sorry. You and Me.
Yeah.
You and Me, not My Way.
Very cool.
You probably already knew that.
Well, it's a great story. It's always good for people to hear it.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you, Richard. Thank you, everybody.
So, I guess this is my final word. Gosh, after Barb's story.
Right.
Anything I could say would be so prosaic. I guess what I'm going to say, apropos of what I'm about to do, is to seize opportunities, to make the best of each moment. I feel like the opportunity to do this show and to work with people. I love working with Lenny Watts, and I love our cabaret community. And it is a community, and to seize the opportunity to be part of a community. And that's, I guess, what I would say. And also, please come to my show.
Oh, gosh, no pressure at all. The thing that I think about more than anything else these days when I'm dealing with other people in any way at all, especially because I'm a person who likes to be funny. I like to make people laugh. But something that I've learned is, and I don't remember who said this, people will not always remember what you say, but they will remember how you made them feel. So as much as I want to say the funniest thing that comes to my mind most of the time, I've taken to thinking about how I'm going to leave people feeling in the room. I just encourage everybody to do that, especially my funny compatriots. And come to my show, of course, obviously on May 15th at 7 p.m. at the Laurie Beachman Theater. Thanks, Richard.
Now, please welcome to the stage Marty Millett and Michael Guerin.
Do together that make perfect relationships.
The hobbies you pursue together,
savings you accrue together,
looks you misconstrue together,
that make marriage a joy.
It's the little things you share together,
swear together, wear together, that make perfect relationships.
The concerts you enjoy together,
neighbors you annoy together,
children you destroy together,
that keep marriage intact.
It's not so hard to be married
when to maneuver as one.
It's not so hard to be married,
and Jesus Christ, is it fun.